Yeah, so I'm not going to talk about dam removal, but instead of what you can do if you can't remove the dams. So we have been working on a project for 2 years in River Dalälven. It's called the Leave Project, Laxfisk in the Nedre Dalälven or Salmonids in the Lower Dalälven. It was initiated by the County Board of Gävleborg, and then it's been working as a collaboration project between the County Board of Gävleborg and Uppsala and the two power companies, Fortum and Vattenfall. And they are the two power companies that have power plants on this stretch. So the first thing we needed to do was to see what are the preconditions and action needs in this river. And this river has got no fish passage now, but we do have some wild spawners down below the first dam. And even though we can't take these power plants out because they're very important to Swedish electricity production, we still need to protect these species. So this is the area. It's south from here, but most of you who came from the south will have passed over the river. And as you can see, it looks more like lakes. It doesn't look really like a river as such. And this part of the river is very young. So that's why it's not so deep. It's still quite a lot of very unique habitats. That's why we also have the Fennebofjärdens National Park, which I highly recommend you to go to because it's absolutely beautiful there. This is a more thematic picture of the river. So we have the Baltic Sea, then we have two power plants, a big lake area, a power plant, another big lake area and a power plant, and then there's three big lake areas, and this is where we stop our the project stops here, so we don't investigate anything above from that. The river used to move in this direction, so most of the water would go down here, but now it's channelized into Untra instead, to the power plant there. But these areas together would be the single most important spawning and rearing area in this area historically, but now there's very little production going on here. It's some in Bredforsen, but Båtforsen is very little. The blue arrows here are where we have spawning areas intact today, and the grey ones are where they used to be or there's great potential to get them back again. So as you can see, the big ones, the best ones we have today are quite far upstream. You remember this picture from Jaco this morning, and as Jaco said, you need to look at the whole system, not just one thing. And we've tried to use that approach for this project to see how we can get the fish up the river, how we can create spawning habitats for them, what can we do about the rearing areas, and how can we get the fish back down again. We haven't looked at the sea face because it's basically a river project. So the first thing we started to do was to biomap all the riffles from the river mouth up to Nas power station. And then we made individual restoration plans for each and every one of these riffles. We laid out transects across the river and we measured these variables. And then we took them and we looked at the fish, what kind of environmental requirements do the fish have? And then we classified them into number one, which is could possibly work as a rearing or spawning habitat but needs improvement. Number two is okay but could be improved. And number three is really top-notch areas. And if to give you an example of how we have worked with this, this is Sevets Kvarn up in Gysinge. This is how it looks. And if we look at it from a spawning point of view, most of it would be a number two. It is really good, but it needs improvement to have a higher production of fish. There are some green areas that are really good. And the fun thing was that in this project, we also did a spawners study. So we put tags on trout spawners and we transported them up and we released them here. And just to see where they would go and what they would do. And the very majority of them went here to spawn, which is so good when nature just agrees with your theoretical work. It doesn't happen often, but When we instead look at the rearing side of it, Sevetskvarn is really good. It's top-notch the way it is. It's got lots of boulders in there, good river flow and everything. So we don't need to do much work here when it comes to rearing. So now when we have all the facts about the riffles in the area, we made restoration plans for each and every one of them. So all these figures that you see here, all will have like a recipe for what do we need to do in this area. And in general, for all the areas, we need to secure the flow to have a more stable flow through the area. We need to flush out sediments to get the gravel back up or put out new gravel for spawning. And we also, because this area has also been used for log driving, so it's heavily cleared out from big boulders. So they need to be put back into the river and distributed in a way so we, so they make good habitats for the fish again. And again, back to this, that this river is not like a river, it's actually like lakes connected with riffles between. And when you do all these restoration efforts that we plan for cost a lot of money, and you need to know that you get something back. And one thing that we thought about was the smolt. How many smolts will survive going through one of these lakes? Because it's not like a river, and it's hard to lean back on earlier publications and studies. So we set out to do a smolt study. We used hatchery fish because there are so few wild fish there to use. And we tagged them with radio transmitters and we released them in Färnebofjärden. They were fairly big, but very, very nice fish. And we only had 5% survival going through the lake. And if you need to pass maybe five lakes, that's not going to work. But then we knew that hatchery smolt are probably quite rubbish at, you know, looking out for pikes and pike perch. And we know that there are lots of them in these systems. So we then, Kalle Gullberg and his co-workers went out to electrofish in the lower parts so we could get wild smolts. And we did the same study with wild smolts. Unfortunately, on both occasions, we had falling flow in the river during the hatchery study and extremely low flow when we set out the wild ones. There we used acoustic transmitters. We set them in Marmafjärden because that's the lake where all fish will have to pass through if they are produced in Dalälven. There's again lots of pike perch. These ones were smaller, but they're basically just as long as the hatchery ones, but just much slimmer. But here we had a survival of 68% managing to get through the lake. And that gave us a cumulative survival of 96.84% per kilometer of lake. So we then used that in the future modeling to see how many fish we would get back. So few, because that would have been a disaster if we couldn't get more than 5% surviving the lakes. And as you remember from the first schematic picture, that there was this key area, Båtforsen, Bredforsen, because there's so little water running through there now, but we know that they've been historically very important. We wanted to look at how much water would we need in this area to get it back to producing fish again. So we made a special study in this area. We worked with Norconsult and we released water 100 cubic meters per second into the area, and then we focused on these velocities, 0.2 to 0.7 meters per second, because that's good habitats for salmonids. And then Fortum supplied us with the water and Vattenfall helped us with doing the measurements out in the area. And at 40 cubic meters per second, we will get 54 hectares of good spawning and rearing habitats in here. And if we get 200 cubic meters, we will get 160 hectares. So it's basically how much water can we get? But then we will know how much surface for the fish we will gain from that amount of water. And if I show you this on a map more, it will be more visual to you. This is an aerial photo of the area, and as you can see, it's amazing. It's like riffles everywhere in this area. It's truly an amazing place. So you want to look out for the yellow color, because that's the good spot. The red and the dark green is not so good. So here we have 40 cubic meters per second. Here we have 70, 100, or do we have 100 here? Yes, 100, 125, and 150. So as you can see, the yellow parts increase the more water we get, but also the red parts increase a bit. So now we know what the river looks like. We know how we can improve the river, all the spawning and the rearing habitats up the river. We know how much surface we can get if we get more water. We know how many fish that will survive going downstream. But then we also have to get the fish upstream and downstream. And here it should, of course, be upstream. I read that as upstream. We have prioritized the solutions for each of these four power plants. And our first priority would be to have a nature-like fishway that also could function as a habitat for some species. The second would be to have a more traditional nature-like fishway, and then it's more technical fishways as a last solution. When it comes to downstream passage, we would aim to spill the fish past the power plants. And if that doesn't work, we would add lead arms to get the fish into the right area. And if that wouldn't work, we would look at a more technical solution. So now, when we have all this information and we know what to do with the power plants, and all this information about the power plants is made by Olle Kalles and Axel at Nordconsult, and the details about it and all the power plants are in the report that you can download on the internet. So it's just I don't have time to go into that here. But now when we have all this information, we took all the data and we put it into a population model that was developed by Kjell Lennartson at SLU in Sweden. And that population model would then give us how many females that would return. And we then used different scenarios. So, and here we have then used the survival that we got from the smolt studies. We've used that in the model, and also the different areas. So in scenario one, we have no extra water. We have only improved the spawning areas that are there today and built fishways. And these are the different riffles, the different spawning and rearing habitats in the river. So if we don't do anything more than improve the areas as is today and build fishways, we will have about 2,185 females returning per year. Then we have the scenario with 40 cubic meters. It then jumps up to 4,300. And then it goes on. And if we have 150 cubic meters, we would have about 7,000 females returning, but then spread out on different areas in the river. And upstream in the river, we would have more losses, of course, because they would have to go through more lake areas, and they would also have to pass more hydropower plants. And also, again, hooking on to what Jaco talked about this morning, these are four power plants in this area. And even though we have very nice areas in the river today, if we don't get any extra water for Båtfors and Bredfors and the key areas, it will be hard because there will be big losses at the hydropower plants. But these key areas are only two hydropower plants up, which makes it so important, not just for the surface itself, but also because the fish only has to pass two hydropower plants to get there. But then we would look at the scenario of almost 7,000 females returning, which is very good. And I got this picture a couple of days ago, so this is going on right now in Ysinge. The digging machines are out there to restore, to follow the guidance that we did in this project. And now they're restoring this area, and the helicopters are out and placing out new gravel in areas where it's needed. So things are happening now already. And this is where you can download the full report if you want to read it more in detail. Thank you.